What surprises you about this story, that they caught him or the how they caught him?
That they caught him at all. Charlie, I think you can put me in the camp of cynics here that wasn't absolutely convinced that the FBI wanted to find this guy. And I know they're saying that this was an arrest that led from, you know, directly from the campaign of public service announcements they put out. But I've just spent the day talking to law enforcement officials who are not in the FBI, who spent their entire career trying to take this guy down the right way. And I haven't found one who believes the story is. Nothing that the FBI has said about this case has ever been on the level. So the idea that this is how it's gone down, I have to tell you, no one I know in law enforcement outside the FBI accepts that.
So how do you think it went down?
Who knows? Maybe she got tired of being on the run. Maybe he got tired of being on the run. But the idea that somebody was watching The View the other day and remembered seeing a woman getting her nails done near Santa Monica, turned her in, and they did this in 48 hours, it just, I don't know. I guess I've done this story too long. I mean, I've been following this close to 30 years, so I guess I'm skeptical about everything associated with it.
Abby, tell me what happened here.
Well, the story we've been given by the FBI is that, you know, they started this media campaign with this 30-second public service announcement trying to raise the profile of his girlfriend, Catherine Grieg, on Monday. And within 48 hours, as Kevin said, they get this tip, supposedly. They won't say anything about the tip, who the tipster was, a man, a woman, whether they were in L.A. or not. But based on the public service media campaign they just started, giving them information that led to this address at this kind of shabby apartment building in Santa Monica. And they did some surveillance on it for a couple hours yesterday. They got a glimpse of them and decided it was really the couple they were looking for. And according to the story we've heard, they went in and arrested them without incident.
Kevin, you wrote a 5-part series, I know, and have done a lot of other work about him. Tell us about who he was and why there's so much fascination with him.
Well, Whitey Bulger was a, you know, his incarceration in the 50s and early 60s for bank robbery was fortuitous for him, because in the 1960s, there was an Irish mob war, and over 60 guys were murdered as a result of it. And when he came out of prison, Whitey Bulger, he was able to rise very quickly in the underworld here in Boston. Now, what happened is he was turned into an informant by the FBI in the late 70s, and that's because the FBI had a national policy to take out La Cosa Nostra, the Italian mafia. The problem with that national policy is it really didn't fit Boston, because in Boston, while the mafia was preoccupied with running numbers and making money and bookmaking, most of the murders carried out in the mob, including those for the mafia, were subcontracted to the Irish mob, which at that time was run by Whitey Bulger. So Whitey Bulger was a far more dangerous murderer and a dangerous criminal than the people he supposedly was used to get. But as we found out during our investigations, is that he was the FBI's highly prized, but highly overrated snitch. He gave them virtually nothing. And the guy was protected. The narrative, I'd say, Charlie, the big difference of today where we sit now is the narrative is about to change. The Justice Department narrative has always been that there was this rogue agent, John Conley, assisted by a rogue supervisory agent, John Morris, who assisted Whitey Bulger and allowed him to go out and kill with impunity. But the reality is there is many other FBI agents and many other FBI supervisors that knew about this for years. And that's where this goes now. The key is who gets to debrief. I mean, we could spend all day talking about the arrest and the tips and all that stuff. I don't think that's the issue. The issue is now that he's in custody, who gets to debrief Whitey Bulger? I would argue that the FBI has an inherent conflict of interest in this and should not control the investigation from here. There are members of the Massachusetts State Police and the U.S. Drug Enforcement Administration who built the case against Whitey Bulger for the charges he is now facing, and who have proceeded in the last few years to push for the truth. I would argue those are the folks who should be able to debrief Whitey Bulger, because the story now goes, who else protected him in the FBI?
Join us online at charlierose.com.